Hi, you have found Rides with Chuck. When I tell people I have a cable program about cars, they break into a big smile and ask the question, are you the guy with the feathered ladies? And I have to say, no, I'm the guy with the hat. But the man with the feathered ladies, Mr. Motorsports Unlimited himself, Mr. Bill Wildt, is my guest today, and doing the honors, asking the questions, is Mr. World of Wheels, McCormick Place, John Langston. John, take it away.
Well, Bill, welcome. Thanks for taking the time to come out here. And I have so many questions for you because over the years, you were the one asking questions, right, as you were filming your shows and that. And now we'd like to know a little bit more about Bill Wildt. Actually, a lot more about Bill Wildt.
Well, I'd be glad to respond to anything. It just interests me that I am sitting literally 5 feet away from one of the cars that was in your garage when I interviewed you about 25 years ago. And you still got the, you don't let go of things.
Yeah? No, I don't.
I'm not talking about that one. I'm talking about the Trabant. That's the one.
That one either.
Yeah. Hopefully, he'll get a cut shot of that so people know what we're talking about. But anyhow, yes, your 40 Ford, who doesn't love a 40 Ford? Okay. Of all of the fat fendered cars, mm-hmm. the 40 Ford is the prototypical fat fendered era car. And I think the best of them all. And you used to have it equipped with a 283 and a four speed. And some firm, you got rid of the 283, I don't know why. But
a little tired.
Yeah, I know, but that was a nice engine. Yeah, anyway, yeah. We're getting off the subject. Go ahead.
Well, Bill, again, thanks for coming here. I have so many questions for you. And I met you, it had to be 1998 when I was the chairman of the World of Wheels, and one of our staff suggested that we come and have you, or that we have you come and cover the show. And I think for the following 10 years that I was chairman for that, we had you there, did a great job.
I would have loved to have been in on that meeting. It's quite a daring move to bring this guy with these girls with these ostrich plume feathers, and it must have been a... I would have liked to have heard the discussion. I really would.
Actually, I must say, Tom Williams, my boss at the time, he was a great guy, a wonderful guy to work for, and he was very trustworthy of his staff. I really didn't have to do a lot of explanation.
Didn't have to sell it. Okay.
No.
Okay.
He trusted us, and he was obviously very impressed with the work you did and the coverage.
Well, you know, it's interesting over the years. I mean, I can't, even now, and I've been inactive for the last, not inactive, but
less active.
Relatively inactive. After 30 years of a new show every week, 52 weeks a year, rain or shine, to all of a sudden, I think we've produced four in the last 2 years, and doing them 5 minutes at a time. Even today, not a day in my life goes by somebody doesn't say, you're that guy that's got the show with the girls with the feathers. Not Motorsports Unlimited, not Bill Wildt. They don't know me or the name of the show, but they know the show with the girls with the feathers. So it's a wonderful hook, and I cannot tell you how appreciative I am of the girls that have participated in the program. More than 400, by the way, in the 31 years I've been producing, more than 400 girls. And I'm so, I hope some of them, the deal I always made with the girls was, you know, we have no money, we're public access television, we have no money to work with, so everybody's a volunteer, including the girls. And it seemed to me, when I was trying to put this together, I want people to watch the show. Otherwise, it's a wasted effort. If people don't watch, it doesn't make any difference how smart you are or how important your message is. If nobody's listening, you can't teach anybody anything.
Sure.
I need to get people to watch. And nothing but nothing attracts attention like a pretty girl. So I wanted, and I said to myself, but I don't have any money. How can I do this? And I said, well, we don't have any money, but it seems to me we do have something to offer. But I worked very hard. I don't know how, I'm trying to think of the name of this program. Rides with, help me. He's showing me the hat.
Rides with Chuck.
He thinks I can see that part. Rides with Chuck. But in any event, the idea was I worked very hard at distributing the show, and it meant I personally bicycled them every single week. I spent a full day every week moving tapes from Sisters, driving to Milwaukee every month and dropping tapes off, and it was a ton of work. But we reached 4.5 million people. And I said, it seems to me I have something to offer these girls. If we have girls that would be appropriate for what we're doing, that would like to have an opportunity to become known, I can make sure we put their name on the screen, we can make sure they introduce themselves on every show, we can also teach them how to do teleprompter work, We can put them in front of 4.5 million people. This is an opportunity for people that might not otherwise have an opportunity. So it seemed to me we had something to offer. It wasn't that we came totally empty-handed. It would have been nice if we had a nice budget. We could have paid them too, because believe me, when we go out to do a show, it wasn't come and stay for a half an hour with us. It was all day. We, you know, when we go to Great Lakes Dragway, we get there at noon and don't leave until past midnight. So so it's an ordeal. But I am absolutely indebted, because without the girls, no question, we don't have an audience. It's the show with the girls of the feathers, and it has attracted an awful lot of attention to motorsport, and that's what's important.
Like Chuck said, everybody remembers that.
Everybody remembers that. It's a wonderful hook, and it worked, and I'm delighted, and I hope they got something out of it, too. We certainly got an audience for our show, which is what I wanted, because I had a message I wanted to get out, and I needed an audience to do that, and the girls brought the audience. So.
Now, Bill, you say your audience is 4.5 million people?
Well, let me say that. Potentially.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
This is public access television. You remember John Gabriel?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
just so the, for the audience, if you don't know, John Gabriel is a wonderful man that we're very good friends. And you know John Gabriel, if you don't think you know him, all I have to do is say, Sunday, 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 a beautiful US 30 drag strips with the great ones, run, run, run. That was John Gabriel. Jan and I were good friends. He was also the announcer at Santa Fe Speedway when I raced motorcycles there years ago. And we got to know each other later on. He started doing television, and I started doing television. Our paths crossed again. And I lost my thought as to where I was going with Jan Gable. Do you recall?
We were talking about your viewer base, how many people.
Oh, yes. And Jan was in commercial television, the Superchargers. I don't know if you remember his show or not. He was on for 11 years. He was on about 85% of the country. Wow. But once a month, he had to make the call to get his numbers, because True Value Hardware was his sponsor, and he had to produce numbers. And so once a month, the call was $5,000. To get the numbers as to what his audience was to prove to True Value Hardware. Well, we don't have $5,000 for a year, let alone just to get numbers. So public access, I don't want to claim numbers I don't have. All I can do is tell you that this cable system has so many subscribers, this cable system has, Chicago, for example, that's 1 million. Now, do they all watch? I'd like to think they do, but
We don't know.
Yeah. But we reach 4.5 million. Okay. Whether they all watch or not, I don't know. Okay. And nobody else does either.
Yeah, actually, my real question is how many states do you cover? Because being the fact that this will be on YouTube, people all over the world will see it. And they you know, if you're from Chicago, you know Bill Wildt, you know the girls.
Well, I like to think so after 31 years, but thank you. No, we got as far as Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and we got as far south as Crown Point, Indiana. But sadly, Indiana lost public access television about 10 years ago. They, you know, it's a. I spent as much time producing Motorsports Unlimited. I spent as much time fighting with the cable companies when public access first came available, cable was brand new. None of us really knew what to make of it. And I stumbled across, I don't want to give you, because it would take hours, I don't want to give you all the details, but I was looking for a way to get the motorsport community on television, because I know that's the way America communicates, so you got to get them on television. And I heard about this public access thing, and I said, wait a minute, I'm the public, I don't have access. Well, I dug into it more, and I found out what it was, and I found out essentially what it is if you want to be a cable operator and come into a community, part of what you have to do, because remember, the community gives them special privileges. They get to use our right-of-ways. They get to string their cables across the alleys, things that you and I can't do that, but they get permission to do that. In addition, they have somewhat of a quasi-monopoly, special business privileges, other people. So in exchange for this, part of what they have to do is make video equipment for the public to use for free. Teach them how to use that video equipment for free. Air whatever they produce for free, with some caveats. You can't make it commercial. It's not a, you know, opportunity to sell things. It's an opportunity to get a message out. It's a free speech platform. So once I found out that this is, you know, a way to get my community on television, this is what I went and worked and did. And for the, I wouldn't be, God, I don't want to overcomplicate the program. If it wasn't for Chris Schutz, there wouldn't have been a Motorsports Unlimited. Chris Schutz and I were together for 25 years, and she passed away, unfortunately, in 1996, and she was a wonderful secretary. She was just, she took shorthand, and believe me, I can pump out letters. Trust me, I can. And she can take something I scratch out on a brown paper bag and turn it into a beautiful business letter. So I'm forever indebted to her, and I miss her in a million ways, but her skills. But when she was alive, we were really working at it. I would go to Milwaukee, you know, and I would go down to Crown Point, Indiana, drift Well, when she passed away, the Milwaukee thing got really difficult for me because now I'm doing all the paperwork myself and everything. And then, and that's why I said where I was going, as far as scolding our community leaders, public access wasn't a gift. It was payment. And you would not believe how many parts of the country our community leaders have given it away. Sometimes for nothing, sometimes for a bag of beads. What do I mean by a bag of beads? The cable operators wanted out of this. They wanted out of this public. It costs them money. I expect it to cost them money. I don't want to give them away access to my right-of-ways and all that. If it doesn't cost them something, I expect to get something. But it costs them money, and they want to, okay. They had all kinds of schemes. And I'm talking about 30 years ago now. They had all kinds of schemes in the beginning. And I fought every one of these. As an example, they'll go to the local community and say, I'll tell you what, nobody's using this public access thing, usually because they made it so difficult. Nobody knew it existed, and those who found out it existed, they made it so difficult that you couldn't participate, unless you're a hardhead like me. But what they do is they would go to the community leaders and say, I'll tell you what we'll do. Nobody's using this thing. We will build a brand new studio in your local high school so the kids can learn how to do television work if you'll just sign us off on this public access thing. Well, what you got there is a box full of junk that in a year will be obsolete and in 2 years won't work at all because television equipment is fragile and needs constant maintenance and all of that. And what you will have given away is you'll have traded away the public's right to get on the air for your children, your grandchildren, for their children forever. It's a terrible deal, and you would be amazed, including Indiana, gave it away. So that was sad. That was over 10 years ago now, but we had a very good following, especially I don't know what there is about northwest Indiana, but that's a heavy-duty car area. It really is. I mean, covered a lot of car shows down there, the Crown Point Car Show, the Hobart's Dam Show. We covered that for years. And the interesting thing, it's interesting, if you go and do a show down there, I run into more handmade street rods than anywhere else I go. For some reason, I mean, T-Roadsters, 40 Ford coupes, think what we call traditional American street rods. They're built by hand, built by guys, not commercially built.
Yeah, that's true.
Built by, yet northwest Indiana, for some reason, it's like a hotbed. And yet, if you go up, say, to McHenry, you're going to run into guys with stock cars. It's a different, and I suppose it really makes sense if you think about it, because, you know, they had Lake Geneva Raceway and Wilmont Speedway, and, you know, they had access to facilities where they could use them. So I guess it makes sense, you know. But there is a difference. But I was really sorry when we lost Indiana, and like I said, Milwaukee just got to be too much for me once a month to drive up there and hand deliver the tapes and drive back after Chris passed away. It was too much for one person. So you asked where we get to. We get as far north as the Wisconsin border, as far south as Beecher, Illinois, and as far west as LaSalle.
After 31 years, I mean, I think of today, there's probably at least two cable TV channels that are dedicated to automotive shows. Mm-hmm. But 31 years ago, you were pretty much the pioneer of this, weren't you?
31 years ago, there was no motorsport on television. Mm-hmm. None. Zero. The only thing that we had was the Indy 500 on tape mm-hmm. delay basis. Wasn't even live. It was tape delay.
So you were the pioneer.
I want to back away from that just a little bit because I like to think I do something a little bit different. Mm-hmm. Motorsports Unlimited is a motorsport program for people who don't care about motorsports. That's what it's designed for. I'm happy to. Quite frankly, I'm so proud of the motorsport community. I've been part of my whole life. Some of the most talented, creative, hardworking people, people that can take a 4-bay piece of sheet metal and with nothing more than a hammer and tin snips turned into these lovely curves that make fun. It's just enormous talent. I'm so proud of what these people do. To me, it's a treat and a pleasure to show it off. However, I'm not showing it off to you and I, because you probably know all this already. Mm-hmm. I'm preaching to the choir. Why would I bother? We already know all this stuff. I'm fond of saying, we know how wonderful we are. But that's not what closes our racetracks. Mm-hmm. What closes our racetrack is lack of public tolerance, lack of public consciousness, understanding, and appreciation of the motorsport community and their activities. And if we are going to, first of all, get more people under the tent, and if we don't get them under the tent, that's fine too, it's not for everybody. At least for them to say, well, it's not my cup of tea, but I suppose it's important for those who are interested to have a place to do it.
Sure.
they'll stop closing our tracks. So we are for that audience. We're not for the gearheads. We're not technical enough. I get criticized by my friends all the time. Bill, why didn't you get into this? Why, you know, because I can hear the channels clicking out there. As soon as I start talking about brake mean efficiency pressure, I can hear the audience drifting off. And I don't want that to happen. There's plenty of opportunities for those of us that are in this sport to educate ourselves and become knowledgeable about things. But the hard part is getting people who aren't interested to have a look and perhaps take an interest in what we do. That's what Motorsports Unlimited is designed for. And to be honest with you, even though there's lots of motorsports stuff on these cable channels and all that, none of them do that. That's what my interest is. So, does that help you?
Oh, absolutely.
Did you know that? Or
ahead of time? No, I did not.
Well, that's funny because John and I have known each other, and I'm sure I've made this speech before. And believe me, I don't let many get away without making the speech.
No, that's very, very, very helpful. I have so many questions for you. Part of it is I'd like to get into your background because, I believe you had a career in the airline industry that you gave up.
You know, I wonder if I'm part of a wonderful family. We're a German family, German back to the 13th century, as far back as they keep records on both sides of the family. And my uncle, Uncle Gunther, Uncle Gunny, he's passed away now. He was a consultant engineering firm in Boston. He was a brilliant guy, and I listened to him. And I had other family members. My father, too, was a brilliant guy. But I remember a lot of what my Uncle Gunny taught me. And he told me once, he says, every man should have at least three major career experiences, meaning something you spend at least 10 years at. That you have, to be well-rounded. Now, I didn't think about it. They told me that was 14, 15 years old, because everybody's, what are you going to be? What are you, who knows when you're 14, what are you going to be? But as I look back on my life, it kind of turned out that way. I had 18 years with United Airlines, a wonderful company. It's like I used to say, I really hated to leave it because it paid good and it was easy. And it was a prestigious company. I always said at the time when I worked there, after having years of experience there, I said if I had to go, because I had trip passes and everything, obviously, but I said if I had to go out and buy a ticket today, I'd buy it on United Airlines. I had that kind of confidence in them. So it was a good company. I liked working there and it paid well and it was easy. I started out loading airplanes and then became a lead, which is sort of like a sergeant of the crews, the ground crews and all that, and got promoted into management and spent 10 years in management. So that was it. However, after that, I went into my own operation of a fabricating shop that I did for about, I'm going to say 12 years, maybe 15, let's say 12 years, something like that. And the way I describe it in my book, becoming so frustrated with the lack of revenue and revenue potential in motorsport. Believe me, I had a Bridgeport milling machine, a Miller Heliarc machine, and the lathe, and all the machine shop equipment, and I'm a pretty complete metal fabricator. And what I wanted to do was to do the prototype work, to develop new ideas and things like that. But I had bills to pay, and every once in a while I call a machine shop friend and say, do you have anything? I really do. Make 600 of these widgets. Oh, I hated that. I just absolutely hated that part of it. I can do it, but I don't want to, but those people had money and they paid. And I used to say to myself, there has to be a reason why there is no money in this sport. And there isn't. There has to be. I'll get to that. But there's no money in the sport. So I said, sooner or later, someone has to put down the tools, lock the garage door, and go out and try to fix this. And that's when I created Motorsports Unlimited. It was my effort to try to do something about this. There are reasons why we don't survive financially, and they can be fixed, but it won't be easy. And it has proven not to be easy for 31 years. but as I'm fond of saying, it ain't over.
Good. That's good to hear.
It isn't over. Now you should ask the follow-up question. What are those reasons, though? But if you want to get to the punchline right away, it's fine.
No, really. I guess what I'm thinking is when I would see you like at weekend events and stuff like that, obviously you're very focused, you're very busy, you're always...
It's a lot of work. Television production is a ton of work.
But you'd only have, 6 hours or something to do as much work as you could do.
And it's funny you say that to one of the girls, poor girls that came down. In fact, she came down to the show at McCormick Place, and she did the first time with us, and she made the inquiries. I said, it's an hour show, and blah, 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 blah. She thought she was going to be there for an hour. She's calling her husband to tell him.
No, that was a surprise.
That was a surprise that we were down there for 5 hours. That was a real shock to me, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's got to be tough, just focusing and scheduling everything in very limited times.
Without question, the most difficult part of doing Motorsports Unlimited is rounding up the girls. It's at least half of the work of doing the program. And so many people say, well, why don't you do it without them?
Wouldn't be the same, though.
It wouldn't be the show. We wouldn't have the audience. And there's no reason to do this if you don't have an audience. It's that simple. They have that kind of power. It's you know, Plato said 4,000 years ago. That's 2,000 years before the Bible. Plato said, nature has given women so much power, it is wise that man has given them so little. Now we'll see if he airs that.
Get a reaction.
Yeah, we'll see if no. Listen, Plato said it. I mean, he's the great philosopher, not me.
You're just quoting him.
Yeah, I'm just quoting him, and it's pretty hard to ignore it because he chiseled it in stone. It wasn't a wet piece of paper, you know. I'm sorry, but go ahead.
No,
go ahead.
Your background, you've raced motorcycles, haven't you?
Yeah, well, I like to think I've raced pretty much everything. Yeah. I started racing cars. My first project was I was in high school still, and we had the old O'Hare Stadium, if you remember O'Hare Stadium. Yeah. And for those who don't remember, O'Hare Stadium was just south of O'Hare Airport on Mannheim Road, about a half mile south of Irving Park Road, but they've moved Irving Park Road, so now it's about a quarter mile south of where it was. But in any event, it was a small quarter mile banked paved oval, and I built a stock car for it. What an incredible experience that was, because I was only 17 at the time. It's funny when you think. I'd been told that you had to be 18. Okay, well, I'm only 17 in high school, I'm building a car. And believe me, I could bore you for an hour on what it took to get that car. I lived in Chicago near Belmont and Damon. And to get the thing dragged on Belmont Avenue down to the Kennedy Expressway, which was brand new at the time, and then drag it onto the Kennedy Expressway, then take it all the way out to Mannheim Road. And I didn't have a tow bar, we had a rope. So, it's a long story. But I'm worried. My concern is they're going to catch me because I'm 17. I don't know that nobody checks. I just assume I'm going to be in trouble because, you know, you're supposed to be 18. So anyway, I got it. I don't know what I was worried about. All I did was get thrown to the back of the pack so quick, my head spun. It certainly wasn't like I was going to, I kind of thought I was going to beat everybody because I really knew what I was doing. I read all the magazines, you know. So it was kind of funny. Interesting enough, a couple of years ago, I was telling that story. The guy says, no, it wasn't 18, you had to be 21. No, I'm pretty sure it was 21, I'm sure. So, I should have been even more concerned than I was, you know. But what happened was, the costs were so high. It's just like today. It's no different than it is today. The costs were so high. To have a competitive engine at that time, you had to have a Traco Chevy. Traco Chevy, you give them your Chevy engine and $5,000 and they give you a Traco Chevy engine. Well, $5,000 at that time was a year's pay for a guy with a good job. It was a lot of money. And there was no, you know, you're racing for a $100 bill. You know, you're not racing for any real money. So the cost just drove me out. I was quite defeated. I got whipped like a puppy and sent home. Made a final stab at the stock car thing when O'Hare Stadium was kind of getting near closing down. They tried an experiment because their car counts were down and all that because of the cost. So they tried racing Volkswagens. In fact, you remember Art Dexter?
No.
Oh yeah, Art Dexter, the great sign painter and car artist.
Yeah, yeah, yes,
Dexter,
yes,
pinstriper,
yes. Yeah, yeah.
Incredibly talented guy. He's the only guy I ever saw that could letter a stock car completely in 2 hours. I mean, he'd arrive with a case of beer and 2 hours later the car went, it was beautiful, he was a very talented guy. Anyway, he was kind of one of the guys promoting that at the old O'Hare Stadium, the Volkswagen racing. If you brought your Volkswagen up to Halfdale, Illinois, where his shop was, he would letter it in that for free. So I drove my Volkswagen up to Halfdale and he lettered the car. And I proceeded, I lived in Franklin Park at that time, and I proceeded to use the car to go to work and back, which was, you know, 5 minutes away at O'Hare Airport, which was right near O'Hare Speedway, or O'Hare Stadium. And the car was all painted in letters, sit in front of my house, and I would drive it to the track and take the back seat out and the passenger seat out and put the megaphone exhaust on and race it for the night and then go back to the pits, put the pieces back together, and drive it home again. But it was short-lived, and they were kind of at the end of their thing. And the same thing happened, by the way, with the Volkswagen racing that happens with everything else. I will not deny that the motorsport community is its own worst enemy in many ways. This real cheap former, I got a third in the feature the first night out. There was about 30, 40 Volkswagens there. I was very proud of it, you know. The next week, a couple of the cars started to sound like airplanes. And they went by me on the straightaway like I was standing still. By the third week, a half a dozen of them were sounding like airplanes. And I says, this is getting out of hand too. I can see exactly what's happening. So I got out of it. But all this time, I always had motorcycles. I had my first one when I was 13 years old. If you want, I can give you a great story about that too. But I don't want to. Always had motorcycles, always liked bikes, always rode in the dirt, always thought I was pretty good. And you know, you had other competitive riders there that I thought was good. And we're out in the dirt in Cartersville one time, and again, I'm licking my wounds over the cost of cars and all that, and how expensive it was to race. And there were some guys there that were, they had what looked like professional race, but they weren't, but looked like to us like professional race bikes. And we were beating them. And the guy said, God, you guys, myself and my friend, you guys ought to go to Sycamore. Well, Sycamore, what's that? Didn't know. Well, Sycamore Speedway. It's on Sycamore, Illinois. You go straight out North Avenue. Okay, so we went out there. Oh, I loved what I saw. Here it was amateur motorcycle racing. They had TT one week and oval track the next week, and my eyes went that big. Boy, this is for me. So we started doing that, and then I found out about Santa Fe Speedway, and then Santa Fe was a professional track, and that's where, you know, there were a couple of guys there that were at Sycamore that were, you know, kind of practicing for Santa, and they were really good, you know, and I said, well, I want a piece of that. So, it's a whole long story, and they're winding us up through an evolution of bikes and everything. I ended up buying a Bull Taco and racing professionally at Santa Fe Speedway, and that started my professional motorcycle racing career. I hope we have enough time to get that part.
Right. You realize that this is our fifth anniversary doing.
Time flies when you're having fun.
Holy smoly.
Gentlemen, on behalf of Motorsports Unlimited, I want to take just a moment to wish you a happy anniversary on your fifth anniversary of doing Wheelie. We need all the motorsports on television we can get, and you guys are doing a great job, and I want to congratulate you.
Cool, this is a real surprise. Can we make a wish?
It's your choice. No, I'm not bringing the girls.
Bill, how many years have you been putting out Motorsports Unlimited?
Oh, a little over 15 now.
How many pros have you put out?
770.
Oh, my.
Well, long way to go.
I'm sure you guys will get there and have a great shoot today.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bill Wildt, Motorsports Unlimited. Right, we're starting this next 5 years on a real good foot.
Yes, we are. We've got the team coming in today.
Yeah, I'm trying to get. They told me you had a brush with Zeph.
Oh yes, heart attack, quadruple bypass surgery.
It was right after you did that little opening for us in Downers Grove. That was like April.
What was it? What did you have?
Downers Grove at the studio.
Oh,
we delivered our birthday cake.
Well, this happened May 20th.
Good to see you.
Yeah, I'm real happy to be here.
Anyway, the idea was I found out, because it's a learning process. You know, I always tell people that one of the things that infuriates me is that people think that the only place education occurs is at a place that's a brick and mortar building with the words school on it, and you give them money and you get education. I don't know what world they live in. I have never built a car. I've never built a motorcycle. I've never gone to a racetrack where I didn't learn. Not once, not one time. It's a wonderful learning experience. And when I went out amateur motorcycle racing at Sycamore Speedway, It was like a whole new world opened up to me, and I found out about the professional level and the amateur level and about TT racing and oval track racing and all of that sort of thing. And I also developed a real affection for two-strokes because the cost of the cars, the main reason is because they're four-stroke engines, and there are tons of moving parts, and everything breaks, and everything has to be titanium in order to last properly, and it's very expensive. Two-strokes have basically three moving parts, and they produce tons of power, and they're very light, and it's very difficult to hurt them. And I learned that in motorcycle racing, is how compelling two-strokes were as far as for an activity like this. But the way motorcycle racing works is that you have to earn so many points at an amateur track before you can apply for a professional license. And then once, and again, things have changed. This was 40 years ago. This was 40 years ago. But at that time, and when you turned pro, there were three levels of professional. There was a novice pro, and when you earned enough points as a novice, you became a junior pro, and when you earned enough points as a junior, you become an expert professional. So, you know, it's an extremely, I'll make no bones about it, it's an extremely dangerous sport. I've been involved with motorsports all my life, but only in motorcycle racing did I personally know people that lost their lives in the sport. The other ones, people had hard hits and bad accidents and all that, but no one lost their life, but in motorcycle racing, mistakes can be fatal. So they have a mature, for something that is dangerous, it's not safe, but for something as dangerous as it is, I think they do a very good job of making sure only those that are really serious and only those that have acquired the skills necessary to compete at that level are competing. Now, how it is now, I don't know. I've been out of it for a long time, obviously, because I got retired when I was 35 with a really, really bad accident in the junior main at Beaver Dam, Wisconsin, half mile. It pretty much ended my career, broke my right leg off completely. Oh, yeah, it was broken off in the middle of the calf and pointed out the wrong direction. Oh, yeah, they wanted to amputate the thing up in Beaver Dam, and I had nothing doing, and they sent me down to, I should know the name of the hospital and give them credit, the orthopedic hospital in Elmhurst. Maybe it's Elmhurst House, I don't know, whatever it was. Anyway, they were able to put it back together, and a year later we found out it didn't heal, and then they did bone grafts, and then it did heal. And it was a wonderful experience for me. You know, let me give you an example of what I mean. Mm-hmm. We can talk, perhaps the most important thing when you're doing engine work, and that is volumetric efficiency. You know, when you're all you all have whatever it is, it was this a 350 now? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Whatever it is. Okay, it was a 283. Whatever it is. And we're all, depending on what kind of racing you're in, you have some restriction. You're all competing with the same size engine. Mm-hmm. So what makes one faster than the other? Well, generally it's volumetric efficiency. It's how well you can make those cylinders actually produce power and work. Now, one of the things I learned in motorcycle racing, and like I say, I might be more thick-headed than others. Others might be able to sit in the classroom and somebody just tell them, and that would be good enough. But that doesn't work for me. I have to see it and feel it. The novice professional level, you were restricted to 250cc motorcycles. And most of us ran single cylinders, Yamaha, I raced Boltacos. They were 250cc singles. However, guys that were in Ohio, because Ohio didn't have, we had Santa Fe Speedway, a little quarter-mile dirt track, but Ohio had lots of half miles, much bigger track, much more room to stretch your legs out. And all the Ohio, not I say all, most of the Ohio riders had Yamaha twins. Still 250cc's, but they're two 125s instead of one 250. Okay, so what's the difference? Those things were not competitive at Santa Fe Speedway, because they were too difficult to ride. They had such a narrow power band. When you grab the throttle, it would go wing, and you had to hold it right at that wing, and it made tons of power there. But in Ohio, because I raced all over the Midwest, and in Ohio, volumetric efficiency becomes very clear. I was certainly well aware that the book said you can make a lot more horsepower. The smaller the cylinder, the easier it is to fill and empty. So if you have two 125s making 250, it's easier for the engine to fill and empty those cylinders. But I'll tell you, nothing brings it home like when you're laying down on the gas tank, going down the straightaway as fast as you can go with your knees tucked in and your elbows tucked in, and the motor is screaming, and you hear this thing coming up alongside as it's going through the gears. They go by you 10 miles an hour faster, and you learn about volumetric efficiency real quick, real quick. Now that drives up. So that's what I'm talking about, educational experience. It wasn't to me just about the fun of riding. I was learning. It was a learning experience for me. And that part was really important. I'm sorry, I didn't mean
no,
to
no,
go right
no.
ahead.
Cars, motorcycles, anything else?
Yeah, no. Well, I did boats too, and I also have 10 hours of solo time, flying.
Really?
Yeah, remember the old Mitchell Field? You must know that you're around here.
Field,
Mitchell Field in Lombard.
Oh, it's gone now.
Yeah, it's gone. Yeah, I took my flying lessons there. I flew a Piper Colt, that's a tricycle gear airplane, a high wing tricycle gear airplane. Learned again, valuable lesson to me. First of all, I'm very glad I did it. Sitting in a classroom and learning the theory of flight and why an airplane flies and all of that, I suppose that's okay for most people. I have to feel it. Mm-hmm. And when you take flying lessons, you can feel it. You can feel the surfaces of the aircraft and how they affect it. That when you apply pressure to the ailerons or the elevators and the movement of the airplane, it's so exactly connected that it's just a wonderful learning experience. And the one thing that I really, and I was happy to learn, I ended up with 20 hours into it, 10 hours of it solo time and all that, and everybody says, why don't you go on and get your license? You need 40 hours to get a license. I said, well, two reasons. First of all, at that point, learning to land and take off was the interesting part. That was the fun part. Now I'm riding around, putting on hours, and it's expensive. I'm not exactly a rich guy, you know, mm-hmm. And it's expensive. But something else. While I was in the practice area, this is Lombard, and gee, I don't know, I'm trying to think about worldwide audience, so I'm trying to give them, Lombard is not that far from O'Hare Airport, and the airplanes approaching O'Hare or in a pattern or something would easily be over the Lombard area. And I'm in the practice area out there at the Mitchell Field, and I'm practicing. And here comes a DC-3, and for those who, yeah, I'm old, I'm sorry. DC-3 was a commercial passenger, probably the first, this is not fair, but the first real commercial airliner in that it's a pressurized cabin and all that. It only held like 15 people, it was two engines, and it was an all-metal airplane. So that was, at one time, when I went to work for United Airlines, they thought Ozark Airlines was still flying DC-3s. The United wasn't anymore, but DC-3 was. But here I'm in the practice area with my little Piper Colt, and here all of a sudden I see this DC-3 coming at me, and it goes the other way. Now, it wasn't close or anything like that, but I could see the people in the windows.
Close
enough is right. And I said to myself, you know what? I really like doing this. However, I have many interests, and I have a feeling the people who ought to be doing this ought to be just devoted to this. Mm-hmm. They ought to be reading all the latest updates and radio frequencies and what they're supposed to, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
You better be sharp on this. And I said, I've learned how to land and take off, and I enjoy that. The problem with this is, if you make a mistake, it can be fatal. That's not the kind of risk that I'm willing to take. I've learned what I've wanted to learn, and I've learned that this is complicated. But somebody that's totally devoted to it, like airline pilots, I have worked for United Airlines long enough to know, and I've talked to many of the captains and the flight crews over the years, and these are really sharp guys. They're the right guys to be there. They really are. But they're totally into it. I mean, they really are. They're not just the airplane, but the latest in ground control equipment. They're just into it, you know? And that's good. You should be into it. But I said, I think I will leave that part of flying to the professionals. So I learned that much about it. I liked it. I enjoyed it. I have no doubt in my mind that if I had to right now, I could go out and get into an airplane and take off and fly it around and probably get it down to the ground okay. But I don't want to devote my life to it. And I kind of thought that was something, you know, people think because I race motorcycles that you must have a death wish. No, I have a life wish. I enjoy life very much and I want to continue to enjoy it. You know, I'll tell you what I compare it to a little bit. I love water skiing. And I love taking people out with my boat and water skiing. We taught girls on the show many times how to water ski and did it as part of the program and everything. And I really enjoy that. And water skiing, I think, is enormous fun. The only thing that happens when you fall down is you get wet. And everybody laughs, and it's fine. Snow skiing, I think, is quite different. I think snow skiing is one of those things, that better be your only sport, and you better pay attention to it. And I think if you look around, the record bears me out. You know, Sonny Bono was killed, the Kennedy member was killed snow skiing, you know, running into trees and things like that. So even though they're both skiing, one is kind of you can do for the fun of it, The other one, you better be real serious about it. Snow skiing, you better be very serious about it. Does that make sense?
It does.
Yeah. Okay.
It does, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Let's go back to your shows.
Sure.
How many shows have you done?
1,414, I think, is the latest number. Yeah.
Because the number I remember is the one that you did in my old garage, because it was 666.
Oh, was it really?
Yes, it was.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that was 1,414, that last count. And it used to be a new one every week, 52 weeks a year. I'm really proud of it. Believe me, Chuck, I'm sure, can tell you, we went 14 years without a rerun. That's a new one-hour show every week, 52 weeks a year, rain or shine, didn't make any difference what happened. By the way, we're not talking about talking head shows. Like, this is easy, sit here and talk and let the tape run. I'm talking about every one of the shows had both location footage and studio footage in it. That's a ton of production, a ton of editing. I spend, on average, and I'm sure Chuck knows this, an hour show takes 40 to 60 hours to edit. Now, when I got into this, I used to argue about it. I figured once I got good at it, I'll figure shortcuts. Well, I have news for you. This is the standard of the commercial television industry. For every minute on the air, it's an hour in the edit suite, and that's what it works out to. Yes, there are some shows that are easier. Maybe you do three big interviews that are 15 minutes each, and you make a program out of it. Yeah, but on average, 40 to 60 hours editing every program.
I have no idea.
Yeah, well, no, that's where the real work is. You see us on location, it's like a McCormick, it's fun, you've got the girls and the feathers and all that stuff, and yeah, it's a lot of work because they're in 5-inch heels and their feet hurt and they tell you, the real work is after you get home and you have to try to make a program out of it. All you do when you're on location is you record on tape. Mm-hmm. Now the work of now make a show out of it.
You make it look easy.
Yeah, make a show out of it. That's where the work comes in. And of course, the more experience you get, it does get easier because you learn to do what you call shoot for the edit. Once you understand editing, once you've been intimately involved with it, you make sure that you do your opens and closes in such a way that invites the edit that you have in mind and all that, and you shoot for the edit. But it makes it easier, but it doesn't make it easy.
Of all those shows, do you have a favorite?
I'm hesitant to do, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you an answer, I'm not going to duck it, but there could be a dozen, could be a couple dozen. Each one, they were special, they had their own charms. But one in particular, do you remember Peggy? Peggy, so the audience around the world knows. Peggy was a drop-dead gorgeous redhead, natural redhead, tall, statuesque, and no one liked to strut her stuff more than Peggy. Peggy O'Donnell, she was born to be a showgirl, but she was married and had three kids. And she was a soccer mom. Like she used to say, she says 6 days a week, she does the T-ball with the kids and all of that kind of stuff, but one day a week she's a showgirl. And that's the way it was. So we got involved with some people out in Hampshire. Do you know what an ultralight aircraft is?
Basically,
well, ultralight is it's a legal description. Ultralight means something.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unimportant. It's an airplane that meets certain requirements. It has to weigh less than 240 pounds, has to fly less than slower than 40 miles an hour. I might be a little off on some of this stuff, but it has to be slow flying. It can only carry a gallon or two of fuel, so you can't go very far, very fast, or very high and all that. But it doesn't require a pilot's license. Anybody can fly one. It's called an ultralight, and it's a legal classification. And I'd done some ultralight shows. I thought it was wonderful. I says, the average guy can actually get into it. I knew about flying then because I'd had flying lessons and everything, and I knew that not everybody, people shouldn't just jump into it. On the other hand, if you use your head, here's a way that a guy could get into it for almost no money. And then I hear about this operation in Hampshire that is saying that they can teach anybody how to fly in one day. So I looked into it. They had something. It was an ultralight aircraft called a powered parachute. Okay, you know some of these parachutes now are very sophisticated in how they actually fly the chutes, but this one is powered, I called them and everything, and Peggy hears what's going on, and Peggy, unfortunately, is more of a daredevil than I would like her to be, and she said, what's going on? I said, these people claim they can teach anybody how to fly in a day, and, I want to do it, yeah, relax, Peggy, you have to find out more about this, I don't want to hurt anybody, and I do know about flying, and long story short, we go out there one day, and I think if it's not our best show, it's one of our best shows. We started at the very beginning. We taped her going through ground school, becoming familiar with it and all that. And at the end of the day, Peggy took off. flew around for 20 minutes by herself and landed. And I really thought that was one of our, but I'll tell you something, Chuck Hitzenthaler was my cameraman for 18 years, and Chuck and I had our hearts in our mouth the whole time. We were absolutely paralyzed with fear. And Peggy's up there flying around, she's kicking her feet and waving. Peggy, pay attention, pay attention. But and like I say, the girls were decorative and all that, but I don't want to suggest that that's all they were. They were a lot more than that. They were fun to be, girls are fun to be around, of course they are, you know. But on the other hand, I feel responsibility. I don't want anybody to get hurt. You know, I'm having to do these things. I want to make sure that this little, in fact, when Peggy took off, I still have the footage. When she took off, first time, obviously we taped it the whole way. It was like a, I'm going to call it a pea patch. I don't know what kind, I'm not a farmer. I don't know if it's corn, I don't know what it was, but it was stuff about 3 or 4 feet high, green, whatever it is. And as she took off, the wind was kind of blowing, and these things kind of require almost no wind because they're big parachutes, the wind moves them. And as she took off, she sort of weaved over to that side, but they're on the radio with her, tell her, just keep the throttle down, keep the throttle down. And sure enough, she clips the, whatever this pea patch was, we see the leaves fly. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But didn't faze her. She just kept going. And when she landed, she's coming there talking her in on the radio and all that. And sure enough, she clips the pea patch coming in on the thing too. And I said, oh, thank God she's down. She's down. Yeah. But I think that was a particularly good show.
Well, my next question was going to be, what was your most exciting show? Well, I think that may have covered that.
Well, it may have, except, like I say, Chuck Hitzenthaler was my cameraman, and Chuck can tell you there's nothing more valuable than a great cameraman that, if you're on the air, I'll tell you something, you develop a relationship with the cameraman, and Chuck knew me so well. You know, he's got a headset on, he hears what I'm saying, and very often I say, Chuck, if you could bring your shot, because he followed the conversation, he was already ahead of me, he was already on the shot, you know, so it's a real good thing. But Chuck couldn't swim, and I wanted to do a show on Chicago's lakefront about going into the Chicago River in these canyons of buildings, of tall buildings. I mean, it's quite a sight if you've ever done it, you know, it's quite a sight down there. And so naturally, and we've got to do everything when we say we're going to do them. When I tell you, we did 14 years without a rerun, I didn't care what the weather were, we're shooting. It doesn't make any difference. Well, there were small craft warnings out. And the only way I could get, we had two boats, one boat to be the camera boat, shoot at the other one. And so we went down to Burnham Harbor and we put the boats in, and there's a couple of guys coming in with boats. Say, hey, you guys don't want to go out there. Well, we're going. We got to, you know. So I left the girls in the van and told them to go downtown Chicago because we could see the waves were serious out there. I said, you guys, one of you can drive. You take the van down to some downtown area. We'll pick you up there with the boat. But this is the only way. There's no way to get in the Chicago River without going into Lake Michigan first. Mm-hmm. So we go into Lake Michigan. We got, and as soon as we turn out of that little harbor area in Burbert Harbor, I'm telling you, the waves, I still remember to this day, it looked like garages. And what I mean by that is I'm topping out over the wave. I've got a 19-foot cuddy cabin with a Corvette motor. As I'm topping out over the wave, all I see is air, and a second later, a garage is rising in front of me. That's the next wave. So I was able to kind of just hit the tops of the waves and everything, but it was some kind of a ride. My other boat's a 17-foot, and that's the one that my cameraman is in. Unbeknownst to me, he's terrified. He can't swim. So we get around, we get into the lock, and we go into the lake. And you talk about madder than a wet hen. This was at least 10, maybe 15 years. He's still mad about it. He is still mad about it. No, he was so near death. He was furious. So you say most excited. That was pretty exciting that day, too. And he's still pretty mad all these years later.
I guess it's humorous now, but at the time it wasn't.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty funny then, too. Chuck did not at all. Chuck did not at all. In fact, when we were doing the boating shows with the water skiing and all of that stuff, I had to convince him. I says, Chuck, you put a life vest on, you really can't go under. The vest will keep you from going under. It's kind of a little funny story. So we're down in the Illinois River, and we're not shooting this. I'm trying to tell him there's nothing to be afraid of, blah, blah, blah. So he puts a life vest on, you know, a ski vest and everything, and get him in the water. And I want him to see that he can't go under. So he's in the water and blah, blah, blah. And I says, yeah, I said, I'll pull you on a tube a little bit too, but get used to it. And I kind of pushed him down. He bobbed up and I pushed him down. I'm in the boat. He's, you know, And okay, he's kind of okay with it. I says, okay. I says, the boat's kind of drifting away now, so I'm yelling at him. I says, I'm going to come around. And all of a sudden, I look back, because the current's moving me a little bit, and he's furiously fighting in the water. And I'm, why? So I quickly zip around, like you would for a skier that's down or something, I quickly zip around him. He's also allergic to bee stings, and there's a bee, and he can't get under the water. So at least he was convinced that he couldn't drown with the life vest, but he was scared to death of the bee.
The poor guy.
Yeah, I put him through a lot. I really, you know, all of the people that have participated over the years, I did put him through a lot. I'm guilty.
Oh man.
That's why I say, being like I am now, I hate to use the word disabled. I guess I am, but. You know, barely able to walk, is for somebody like me, it's like being in jail. It's just terrible. It's terrible because I spent my life, you name it, boating, snowmobiling, flying, what have you. I enjoy all of these things thoroughly. I haven't ridden a motorcycle since I had the surgery. It's over 2 years now. So, yeah.
It's gotta be killing you.
Oh, it is. Oh, it really is. It's, yeah. Well, anyway, that's sad. So, but you didn't follow up the question I said earlier is what is the reason? Why there's no money in motorsport? You want me to answer that now?
Why not?
You have time? You sure?
Sure.
America, and probably the rest of the world, but I can only speak for America, is totally and completely influenced by television. It influences everything we do and say and think. There's no way around it. I'm 74 years old. I'm old enough to remember before there was television. Mm-hmm. I've watched it change us in every way, and it has changed us in every way. There's been some good changes, there's no question about it. But there are things that we don't even think about that it influences us. For example, in the early days, one of the popular shows, and I remember it very well, was Jackie Gleason's Honeymooners. I remember it was, remember 1955, 54? Okay. Now, what do you remember about that program? Anything at all, just a visual. I think Chuck is doing Chef of the Future, but...
pretty much anything Ralph Cramden did.
Yeah.
Because he was kind of a boob, you know.
Okay, but the thing you probably didn't notice, but you were influenced by, was the setting. Here they had this married couple, had this crummy one room, the only room that you saw, that apparently was a bedroom they'd duck into. But this one room had their so-called dining room, just a wooden stick table with wooden stick chairs. And a sink that was sort of their kitchen, just right away from it, and plain walls, no curtains on the windows or anything like that. You'd never see that today. You know, why do you suppose that is? Because it gives people a feeling of what normal is, and none of these advertisers want you to think that's normal. They want you to buy sofas, they want you to buy ranges, they want you to buy television sets. They don't want you to start thinking that this is, you become inured to it, and they don't want you inured to that. But in the early days, we weren't all that, you know, today product placement is a big thing. People pay a lot of money to make sure that Coke can is sitting where it's supposed to sit. Mm-hmm. But in those days, we weren't conscious of that sort of thing. So television is totally influential in our lives. Now, what does that have to do with motorsports and not being any money? I'm going to make this very brief. It's a long speech. I'm going to make it very brief. We are competitors in the sports entertainment marketplace. And we allow our competitors for public attention to dominate the public attention on the public airwaves. And as long as that happens, we will continue to die. And we are all but dead now. All of the tracks that I started at are all gone without replacement, every one of them. I'm not talking about this might happen. It already has happened. You know, we just lost Ileana. I'm sure you probably know that.
No.
Oh, yeah, Ileana didn't open this year. It was bought by the Sherrillville, town of Sherrillville, turned into a park. So that's another one. It's just on a long list of Raceway Park and Santa Fe Speedway. We don't know, Hare Stadium and Lake Geneva Raceway and blah, blah, blah. Goes on and on and on. And they all die for exactly the same reason. Failure to generate enough revenue to fund themselves and flourish. I asked the best question. Did you know Kevin Dawson? Mm-hmm. Kevin Dawson, and he was the eighth episode of Motorsports Unlimited, so it was a long time ago. And I really admired the guy. First of all, he's very bright. He's also very open. He's willing to... He bought Lake Geneva Raceway. Now it's like 30 years ago, whatever. But he bought it and he came on the show and he talked about all his big plans. He's going to build a new race, all of which he accomplished. He did it. I really admire the guy. He had to risk his house. That in itself would be a whole show. It's wonderful. But it closed. So his eighth, I don't know what number it is that the show when it closed, but it was 20 years later that it closed. And the final question I asked him, because we went through the whole thing, and he was quite open about what it costs to run a racetrack, what it costs for insurance, but he gave it all away. And what was closing the track was the adjacent property had been rezoned to residential. And along with it being rezoned residential, all of a sudden he came under noise restrictions that he could not meet. Okay. And my final question to him was, if every time you ran an event, if you had 40,000 people show up buy tickets, would you be closing? He said, oh no, we'd be open forever. He says, because then you have the resources. He says, you can fight it when they come along, they're gonna rezone the thing and say, oh no, you're not, because that'll put me out of business. You're not gonna do that. And you can afford to hire a law firm and take care of that. For example, nobody's trying to close Wrigley Field. And that certainly disrupts the neighborhood and screws everything up and they make noise and everything, but they make money. They can defend themselves. We can't. We're hanging on by our fingertips, and the first ill wind that comes along, we're gone. We're dead. Now, what is my complaint? People often think, well, you know, the Indy 500 is on TV now, Daytona. I said, you don't understand. The most important thing on television is the free time. The most important thing is, I used to say four times a day, now it's constant. It's at least 10 times a day. 7 days a week. We've got the morning news, the noon news, the afternoon news, the early evening news, the evening news, and every single one of those has a sports news segment. And what do they tell you about in the sports news? I'm saying this generically. The Cubs, the Bears, and the White Sox. Now, yeah, I know the Bulls and the hockey. Okay, Cubs, the Bears, and the White Sox, Cubs, the Bears, and the White Sox, all of that kind of thing. That becomes normal to you. You identify that's, well, wait a minute. Those are private businesses. They don't belong to the people of Chicago. They don't belong to the city of Chicago. They're no different than Walmart or Sears. They're a private business that's selling you tickets. Why do they get this free overtime? More important than that, why do they get it? We don't. We are allowing our competitors in the sports entertainment marketplace to dominate the public consciousness through the airwaves, the public airwaves that belong to all of us. And when I say they belong to all of us, I know what I'm talking about. I've studied the broadcast industry from its inception with the Radio Act of 1927, followed up by the Communications Act of 1934, and all of the Supreme Court cases, including Red Line 1969, that declared over and over again, these are the public airwaves. They belong to all of us. And the broadcasters are required to share them. Where's the cop? Until we fix this problem. I'll give you an example of how important it is. For whatever reason, I'm a big Bear fan. I enjoy the Bears and all that kind of stuff. But for whatever reason, I don't care about hockey. And I just don't. I can't understand how people can watch a game on television where you can't see the object of the game. You can't see the puck. How you can watch that, I don't know. But for whatever reason, I have good friends that love it, and they're dedicated to it, and I respect them and all that. But for me, I don't care about it. I don't care anything about it at all. However, some years ago, when this guy, Wayne Gretzky, was scoring, you're smiling, okay, the name means something to you. And why does it mean something to you?
He's the great
because
one.
Of television. That's why you wouldn't have heard his name if it wasn't for television. Mm-hmm. Because every day, four or five times a day, 7 days a week, they're telling you that he scored two more, he scored another one. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't care anything about this sport. I got interested in it. How could you not? It dominates your consciousness. Mm-hmm. Do you know Tony Izzo?
I know of him.
The unparalleled, unprecedented, 9-time Santa Fe Speed track champion. Sports entertainment marketplace, same geographic area. Mm-hmm. Nobody's ever heard of him. Nobody ever knows him. Yet his achievements were certainly far greater than Wayne Gretzky's ever were, could be. And yet, because television ignored motorsports, our people can't profit, our people can't even survive, and that's why we've closed every single racetrack over my lifetime. Okay. If we don't fix that problem, that's not good enough to just say it's a shame. It is a shame, yes it is, but they're hurting people. Mm-hmm. Like I say, sooner or later, somebody has to put down the tools, lock the garage door, and go out and say, I'm going to try to fix this. Now, I've had a lot of people say to me, well, Bill, you can barely walk now, you're 74 years old, everything like that, aren't you sorry that you As I'll tell you what, if this is the end, if I'm done, and I wasn't able to fix it, I can live with saying, I tried. What I can't live with saying is, I didn't try. Mm-hmm. He's telling us to wrap
ending.
It up.
That's a good ending. And my two little cameras just died out.
Oh, okay. Right, well, hopefully you got it.
We got it.
Okay. Okay.
The camera's still running.
Okay.
I was going to ask you about the rock.
Oh, we're done. I can tell you about it if you want.
I just want to get in the shot, too.
If you want to roll on that, I'll give him the rock story, too.
We still got a little more time.
Oh, you're still rolling on one? This guy's dead?
He's already gone.
Okay. You want to change batteries or anything or do anything?
I can't on those ones.
You're done on them? Okay. You want us to just pick up the rock story?
Go ahead. Yeah,
okay. You got something else?
Just two things left.
Okay.
The one thing that when I think of Bill Wildt and I think of what you do, the one thing that I really looked forward to was when you did your motorcycle trips and every day you would send an email. I thought that was so great. I mean,
thank you.
I looked forward to opening my email every day to see what Bill was up.
Okay, we better tell the audience what you're talking about because it makes no sense to them at all. All right, very quickly I bought a street bike. I hadn't ridden on the street for some time. I raced motorcycles. To me, I never really thought much of motorcycles as being practical. I love bikes, always have. I spent 5 years racing them at a professional level, but I always thought they were fun toys, but not particularly practical. And when you get too old to race, and too injured, and too hurt, it's time to move on, move out of it. So I got away from it, and then I spotted a street bike that I got interested in, because it kind of reminded me of a BSA that I had years before. And anyhow, it was a Suzuki, a Japanese four-cylinder motorcycle, a used bike. I bought it, and I decided that I wanted to take a motorcycle road trip. And quite frankly, what had happened was I had a heart attack and quadruple bypass. And while I'm laying in the hospital, I'm thinking about it, that I'm originally from the memorable part of my childhood, was upstate New York. And it's all country there, it's a beautiful country. And I've been gone for 50 years and I never went back. And I'm laying in the hospital saying, geez, I wish I'd made that trip back. I never really did that, you know? So I said, if I survive this, especially with it. So I did. I set the bike up for touring, put saddlebags on it and all that kind of stuff. And I said, I'm gonna make TV programs, because everything I do is TV program. There's no part of my life that's, I mean, my house looks like a TV studio. There's no part of it that doesn't look TV-ish. So anyway, I decided to do it, and the way I did it was I said, okay, I'm going to take the audience along for a ride. And I said, stand up at the start, here's what I'm going to do, blah, blah. But I never tell people where I'm going. I want that to be part of the interesting part of the thing is, where's he going? And then the Indiana state line, you got to welcome to Indiana sign, okay, we do that. Then Ohio state line, got Indiana sign, everything. Then when we get to New York, at the New York state line, I'm hoping people are thinking, New York, what's he doing there and all that. And what I was doing was going back to my boyhood home that I haven't been back to for 50 years. That was the story of all that. And I taped things there that I still remembered and blah, 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 you might remember the gorge and all that sort of thing. While I was doing this, it occurred to me, the first stand-up piece I did at the Indiana State Line, I said, you know what, I've got the tripod sitting there, because I'm by myself for all this, and I got the tripod sitting there, and I took the video camera off of it, and I'm putting it away, and I've got the still camera. I said, you know what, I'll take a still shot while I'm here. So I put the still camera on the tripod, and I walked back over to the shot, self-timer, did a smile, took the picture. When I got home, everybody's asking me, where were you? I said, okay, yeah, I'm going to make a TV program out. That's going to take several weeks. It wasn't a TV program. It was like five or six, which turned out to be among our most popular shows of the motorcycle road trips. People, not just bike people, car people really liked the motorcycle road trips. Because it turned into, so the audience knows, that was turned into be the first of many that I took. I went to Kansas City. I went to, Sweetwater, Tennessee, and a number of road trips. Anyway, I says, I got all these still shots. I think I'm going to send out a little like a travel log. And I just wanted to tease the audience with it. So I did, and you have to remember, internet was kind of brand new at the time. It was a new thing for all of sending emails and stuff. Like today it's nothing, but at the time it was new. And what I liked, I saw a potential there for storytelling. It's just the way I think, I said, a pic and a paragraph. If I have a picture and then a little paragraph kind of explaining it, I can tell this whole story with pics and paragraph. So I decided I had an email list. So I decided, hey, you would be amazed at how many people followed that thing day after day, because it took like 30 days to to send every one of them out. And people often said, I had my morning coffee with it. I watched to see what you sent and all that. Yeah. And I'm very appreciative. I'm glad you liked it. I'm glad people enjoyed enjoying doing it. Interesting enough, and so I did that on the next one that I did. The second road trip was when we were young men. I was like 21 years old. My high school rat partner and I, Todd, young guys. You know the song, but you probably don't know. You're a little younger than me. Kansas City, do you know the song?
Kansas City? Here I come.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. The feature of the song is they got some crazy little women there. I'm going to get me some. Mm-hmm. And naturally, Todd and I, we got to go to Kansas City. So we tried to go to Kansas City. I had my BSA, he had his Norton, and we decided we didn't have saddlebags, we didn't have windshields, we didn't have anything. We're just young guys, you know. We jump on the bikes. It took us 3 days to get to St. Louis. 3 days. Because of constant breakdowns. Oh, it was terrible. Not to mention drinking. And because that was the time when go-go girls were popular, and every place along Route 66 had go-go girls, and the reliability, oh, it was terrible. Plus, he crashed 3 times, and it was terrible. We had all we could do. This is when I was 21 years old. We had all we could do to get both machines. I had to start his every time on the way home because he was so hurt from the accidents he had. I had to start it, and that thing wouldn't start for nothing. And we got back to Chicago. He took that Norton, which he had spent the entire, this was kind of early summer, he had spent the entire winter with a perfect restoration. He had a rare Norton Manxman. And those who know Nortons know that Nortons, you have the Norton Atlas, which is very common and all that. But not many are familiar with the Manxman. The Manxman was a 600cc vertical twin. Not a 650, a 600 vertical twin. Kind of a rare bike. And he had done a beautiful restoration and destroyed it on our trip. That was supposed to be to Kansas City, but we only got as far as St. Louis. And had to drag our broken bodies and bikes back home. So after the New York trip was successful, I wanted to do another road trip because I enjoyed it personally too. I liked it and the audience liked it. So I said, okay, I think I want to do that because Todd, I had heard, had passed away. He lived in California the last 15 or 20 years or something, and you know, we lost touch, and he'd passed away, and I says, you know, I think I'm going to try that because this Suzuki had proven itself that motorcycling has really changed. This thing just runs and runs, starts at the touch of a button, nothing breaks, you know, you don't have to fix them all the time. It was wonderful. And so I said, I'm going to do the trip that Todd and I started when we were 21 and didn't finish. And kind of the important part of that trip, there was other parts too. The important part of that trip was when I got to Kansas City and I found 12th Street and Vine, and it's still there. And in fact, the city fathers, what they had done was, the people don't realize, Wilbert Harrison was the singer's name. That was really his only hit. But he was from a very bad area in Kansas City, a projects area. And when he was there, when he wrote the song and all that, it wasn't projects, it was just dilapidated 3 and 4 flats and falling down. And when I got there, because it took me, it was really hard to find it, 12th Street and Vine didn't exist anymore because they had paved over it and put up projects buildings, you know, like Cabrini Green and all that. They'd done that there. But they left a sign in a little grass area with the 12th Street and Vine thing. And I thought, boy, that's really cool. I'm glad they. So I did the thing there, but then I rolled my eyes up and said, Todd, you didn't miss much. There's no crazy little women here. It didn't work out like I thought it was going to work out. And let's get out of here, you know. Yeah. Interesting enough, and this is a guy that comes to the Rock every year. 3 or 4 years later, I aired the program. There was more to it than just Kansas City. I did some other things. But anyhow, did the Kansas City thing. A guy with a Fiero duplicated the trip. Which was, to me, I can't tell you how flattering that is. That I inspired somebody to do something, a road trip. It doesn't have to be on a bike. That's fine. You got a Fiero, do it on a Fiero. Do it on a T-Row. I don't know. You can do it on your coupe. Mm-hmm. You know, why not? Yeah. And he brought back pictures, and I couldn't believe what the city fathers in Kansas City had done. They've turned us into a whole little park. It looks like piano keys. It's really nice what they've got, and it's a little tribute, and it says Wilbert Harrison. None of that was there when I was there. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, good for them. They recognize the achievement of this guy and what the attention that he brought to Kansas City and all that. So I thought that was pretty cool. And he came down to the Rock, and he just kind of mentioned casually in the interview that he had duplicated the trip and all that. And you know how it is when I'm working. I usually have my headset, I've got an idea, I've got a storyline in mind that I'm trying to achieve and all that. And it kind of went in sort of one ear and Janine, I don't know if you remember Janine or not. Janine was with us for a long time. And Janine says afterwards, boy, that's really interesting, the guy, blah, 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 blah. Well, Janine is very good at that with the computer, and I contacted him, he sent me pictures. And so then the following year, when he was down at the Rock, I was able to put the pictures up and all that. And it kind of makes doing the show worthwhile, when you inspire somebody to do something like that. So I felt good about that. Now you probably want to know about the Rock.
You mentioned the Rock, yes. If you're not from Chicago.
If you're not from Chicago, it makes no sense. Yeah. All right. Let me start it out the way I like to start it out. Do you know where the first automobile race in America was held?
In Chicago, from Evanston to the South Shore.
Well, at least you got to Chicago right.
Yeah.
It was held right here in Chicago, Thanksgiving Day, 1895. And it was from, I like to say, the shadow of the Museum of Science and Industry. It's actually about a quarter mile south of the museum. But you can turn your head when you're standing at the Rock and see the museum, so people know where it is. In any event, it was a really historically important thing in that the word automobile didn't exist, the word car didn't exist. And what had happened is, you have to remember at the time, this is before radio, so we're talking about before television, it's before radio. Newspapers were very important. Chicago had at least a dozen important newspapers, and they were very competitive with each other. And one of them was the Chicago Times-Herald. And the Chicago Times-Herald, Herman Kohlstadt was the editor and publisher, and he'd taken a trip to France, and he saw the world's first automobile race from Paris to Bordeaux, and he couldn't believe what he was looking at. First of all, there was 70 or 80 competitors, something like that. He had never even heard of these contraptions, these things, but he thought he was seeing the future. And he knew there was nothing like this going on in America. If you remember, we were a farming country. 95% of the people in 1895, 95% of the people lived on farms. We weren't industrial at all. And he knew nothing like this was going on in America. Now, if you remember, the automobile was invented in Germany in 1886 by Carl Benz. Mm-hmm. And this was in France I want to say 1893, I believe it was, 93 or 94. When they had the world's first automobile race in France. He sees it and he says, well, how can I inspire this in America? I want Americans to start working on these things. I think this is going to be the future. So he gets the idea, well, how can I use my newspaper to stimulate this activity? So he decides he's going to run a race, sponsor a race. And he's going to offer a big crash. It doesn't sound like much now. It's like $5,000, something like that. But in their money, I did the calculations. It was like $250,000, $250,000 to win. This was serious money, So enough money where people will buy some stuff and start welding, start making some things. Yeah. There's a chance of a reward here. So in any event, it's a longer, I'll brief it, because he started out, he wanted to do from Milwaukee to Chicago, couldn't get it done because it's too many counties and states and laws. So he says, okay, it'll be from Chicago to Waukegan and back. And he gets the entries all there, and by the time the day he's got set for the thing, it comes around, there's only two guys that are actually ready. Nobody else is there. You can't run a race with two cars. So he says, okay, I'm going to postpone this. These two guys says, hey, wait a minute. You advertise money here on this. Mm-hmm. You got to run this race. So he says, okay, he says, I'll tell you what. Yeah, I'll throw some extra money in it. We'll throw some more money in it. But it's just going to be an exhibition. It's not going to be the real event. But we'll run like we planned to from Chicago to... Waukegan and back. But it's just an exhibition. So they did, and the two guys ran. And the guy that ended up coming in second place ended up winning the real race, ended up winning that one. And the guy who won the real race, Frank Duryea, ran into a hay wagon in Libertyville. Yeah, an interesting history, because we know these people around the world watching it won't mean anything to them, but that's a fairly local suburb of Libertyville. It's not that far away, maybe 20 miles or so from where we're sitting right now. So it's interesting that it's a piece of history. And in any event, so they got their little prize, but he had set the race date back to Thanksgiving Day, okay? 3 days before Thanksgiving, they have a freak snowstorm in Chicago. And they got a foot of snow and the city is considered impassable. Now, meanwhile, you got to remember, these are competitive newspapers, and all the other newspapers around the nation are making fun of him with this folly. Again, nobody knows what these things are. They don't know what they are. There's no name for them. In fact, part of this thing, part of this contest, is they had a contest to name these things. There was a cash prize just to name what these things were. This is history. I'm not making this all up. It's all recorded. It's all recorded history.
Yeah.
And so that was part of it. In fact, a little aside here, because it didn't stick. I've said it so many times. Do you know what the name that won the contest was? For what to call these things? It didn't stick. There's a hint. Yeah, you should. No. You've been down to the Rock a number of times. And I'll get to why we call it the Rock in a second. But motorcycles. Not motor. Moto. M-O-T-O cycle. Motorcycle. That was the name that won the contest. Didn't stick, but that was the name that won the contest. They didn't want to use the word automobile because it sounded too Frenchy, whatever that means. It sounded, but motorcycle, but it didn't stick. In any event, Thanksgiving Day comes, snowstorm. There's no way he's going to delay this. He's already the laughing stock of not just around Chicago. He's the laughing stock of the country. His ridiculous amount of money he's putting up for this nonsense and all that stuff. So come hell or high water, you're going to run. So there's only six cars there. Cars, if you want to call them cars. Two of them are electric, four are gasoline powered. And he has to shorten it. Instead of going to Waukegan, they're going to go to Evanston and back because of weather conditions. It was considered impassable. So they run the race, and I won't go through the whole story. It's a really, I think, a really interesting story. They run the race, and the winner is the Derier. Derier, it took him like 8 hours and some minutes for his 54 miles, whatever it was. But what was interesting about this is that the fact that they were actually able to do it, that these contraptions could actually get through all that snow, could actually do it, that opened people's eyes. That became a big deal. Now, how big a deal? The Derier, 1 year later, became America's first production automobile. And 4 years later, we had over 200 automobile manufacturers in America. So if you wonder if motorsport is important, you're darn right it's important. You're darn right it's important because the auto industry is what has been the economic engine of our country for the past 100 years and counting. So it's very, very important. Now, The Rock. The reason we call it The Rock is because I had been talking about this. I was aware of what had happened in 1895, and I'd been talking about it on the show for 2 or 3 years, and I wasn't aware of anything going on. And I told the girls, you know, we're going to go down to this area south of Museum of Science and Industry, and if nothing else, I'm going to stand there and grouse about the fact that nobody's making a big deal about this, and I can do an hour of grousing, believe me, and that's what I'm going to do. So I go down there to do an hour of grousing about it. I'm doing my opening stand-up piece with the girls, and I'm explaining to them how it was a different time back in 1895, and the building behind us was the Museum of Science and Industry, but the Museum of Science and Industry didn't exist in 1895. What was it? It was a leftover building from the Columbian Exposition of 1893, and it was the first building powered by alternating current. Bet you didn't know that. Tesla had the contract, and they had to design everything, including a power generating station to power the entire World's Fair of 1893. All part of history, you know, very interesting. And so I'm grousing, and I'm getting into the, you know, something as important as this has been the economic engine of our country for well over 100 years. And no celebration, no news coverage or anything. Meanwhile, while I'm doing this, out of the corner of my eye, I'm seeing across the street, Cornell, I'm seeing some kind of activity. And it struck me as odd. And somebody's trying to put a banner up. And I told Chuck when we closed off the first pieces, I gotta see what's going on over there. So I go over there. Well, sure enough, there was in fact something going on. These guys were, there was a group called the American Autosport Centennial Committee, and they were putting up a banner. They were having a lot of Chicago dignitaries, and they were planning a race, brass era cars, over the original route. And they were going to dedicate this piece of granite with a bronze plaque on it, identifying this as a start and finish of America's first auto race, this thing we affectionately call The Rock. So we went down and we covered the dignitaries making theirs. We were the only ones. You'd think news coverage would be there or something? Nothing. Nothing at all. We were the only ones, and we got some of the cars leaving and all that, you know, and we got the Chicago dignitaries and everything that they had to say. But I made a commitment at that time. I thought it was so important. I said, from now on, every year, Thanksgiving morning, from 9 until noon, Motorsports Unlimited will be here. And anybody that shows up to acknowledge the day, we'll put them on the air. You've been down there before. Mm-hmm. You know what we do. Yep. We put them on the air, and that's what we call our gathering at The Rock. Mm-hmm. That's the story of The Rock. That's how it all turned out. That's how it all came about.
Well, Bill,
go ahead and tell the truth. We've been stopped in the middle of our conversation because we're out of time. Go ahead.
Well, that's true. Yeah, yeah. The time flew by. Yeah. And Bill, I can't thank you enough. Hopefully we'll sit here and talk for a lot longer. I think we could go on for hours, but thanks so much.
I'm happy to do it, and hopefully the one thing I want to tell people is if I can get myself back together physically, Motorsports Unlimited isn't gone yet.
That's the best thing I could hear. Okay. Bill, thanks so much.
Thanks for coming out, Bill.
Thank you.